They call it white gold, a delicacy selling for $130 a kilo in fish shops right now. Whitebait. It's also on the menu at some of our finest restaurants. But that could all come to an end very soon. Some say whitebait are facing extinction, and there are calls for recreational catch limits and a complete commercial ban. That'll mean no more fritters for most of us. But are we being fed the truth? Here's Matt Chisholm.
Spring in South Westland. A place where time stands still.
You wake up in paradise every morning. What more could you want?
This is an annual pilgrimage. They come for the fishing and the lifestyle. For 3 months each year, West Coast whitebaiters come home.
Yeah, you just get away from it and you switch off, you just relax.
I love it. And it's something I'll do till I die.
Whanganui's 75-year-old Norm Arthur has been hanging his hat and hast for more than 40 years.
What is so special about here?
You can just look around and see it. You don't have to be told. It's so good. Yeah, we've got a good community in the huts. Now, we used to have some raucous parties.
Have you stopped having them?
Well, we got older and more sense, I think, is the answer to that.
Norm's long time home away from home, though, is under threat.
Wankers. Greenies.
The greenies, as Norm calls them, want change, and they want it now.
There's not a lot.
They say this national treasure is in terrible trouble.
Four out of the five of the species involved in whitebait patties are moving towards extinction. Three of those actually have the same threat classification as, say, the North Island brown kiwi.
But not everyone agrees.
Forest and Birds calling for a commercial ban and catch limits on recreational fishermen. What are they basing that on?
It's not being based on evidence, because there is no evidence.
Whatever happens, Norm should be fine. He doesn't catch much, doesn't sell any. For others, a law change could be huge.
We good?
But just trying to find those people is a hell of a challenge.
One more time. Pump. Start a button, pull back, we're away. You must be Nan.
Hi, I'm Nan.
Nan, nice to meet you, Matt.
Hi, Matt.
G'day.
Nan's family has been whitebaiting on the isolated Cascade River, somewhere between Haast and Wanaka, for 70 years. You can only get here by chopper or boat. Cameras have been here just once. That was 40 years ago.
Hi, is that NK? NK's where you're calling. Do you read, Dick?
Little Shane. Not so little anymore. His Uncle Michael is still manning the same stand. He hasn't missed a season in nearly five decades. The family has grown older, but not much else has changed.
We all work together for a common goal that our fathers and aunties began. We're carrying on a very strong tradition, which we're very proud of. We would feel like we are not fulfilling the wishes of our parents if we didn't keep the tradition going.
During the West Coast whitebait season, from September through to November, about a dozen people live here.
Always hold the screen downwind of you, otherwise it'll push you into the river.
It's not always this beautiful. They fish every day, rain, hail or shine.
We catch whitebait by building these stands, and then we put the screens in and we sit here for 5.5-6 hours, which is a tide, and patiently wait for them to toodle-oodle along the screens and into our net. When we've got enough to make it economic, we put the whitebait in the plane, and that goes over to Christchurch to the shop, which is really the distribution centre.
Cascade Whitebait is one of our biggest commercial operators.
This is cool.
Delivering tons of these translucent little treats right across the country. We're talking $130 a kilo.
Oh, I think it's similar to oysters and other seasonal, you know, delicacies of New Zealand. We have one or two communal feeds and we really enjoy it. But a lot of the time, we send it to you guys in Auckland.
Yeah, yeah. We're a long way from Parnell and Ponsonby right now, man.
For some, though, commercial white baiting is no joke.
Nan, if you read the papers, you'd think you guys are pushing these wee critters to the brink.
I don't think we are. From our records, which go back a long way, we have no concerns about our fishery. Our graphs show about a 7 or an 8 year cycle.
Day 5 of this season.
There's a wee bit there.
And Nan's having a good day at the office.
Yeah, that's a pretty good day's fishing. Let's hope that all the other stands have had a wee bit of an increase as well.
The sun's going down, but there's still plenty to do.
So we're picking out any sticks, smelt, crabs, any bait that looks like it's old.
Hand on heart, you're not catching a lot less than you used to.
No, we're not.
Would you still be here if you were?
No, because this business, flying a plane and all the infrastructure needed to house people for 3 months, there's a lot involved in it. And it's not tens of thousands, it's hundreds of thousands to make it work.
Because those costs haven't been covered yet, there's no fritters on the menu tonight. Well, at least not for the crew.
You haven't told the others about this, have you?
No. It's our little secret.
Nan and I, though, are sampling today's catch.
It's starting to smell really good, Nan.
Lovely. Hot.
This is delicious. You've got to eat it piping hot, don't you?
If this family can't sell their white bait, 70 years of business and pleasure would come to an end.
It's unfair to, you know, let the guillotine drop on something that you don't know enough about.
What would it mean for your family if the guillotine did drop?
Well, that would be the end of everything. Our children who have grown up here would not have the opportunity to come back. Yeah, it would be heartbreaking.
Because this is a taonga, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. Our fathers, they were really poor and they worked really hard, and it's part of our duty to keep it going. You're going to have to stop. I'm going to have to go and wash my face. Oh, dear.
For now, this morning's haul could be served up in restaurants right across the country as early as tomorrow. The new government, though, is looking into whitebait sustainability right now and could put a stop to commercial fishing.
If you can't sell whitebait, then restaurants can't buy it. They can't serve it to you. It means you can't be buying it at the fish and chip shop to take home if you don't happen to be able to whitebait. It means you can't take whitebait and swap it with someone in your whānau because they can't whitebait either, because that's a commercial transaction.
After the break,
It has huge consequences.
What do the experts actually know about the state of whitebait?
The data just don't exist.
And could farming the fish end the debate?
Can you keep up with demand?
Oh, definitely not. No.
Whitebaiting. It's as Kiwi as fish and chips. The lifestyle as treasured as the wee fish fritter is famous.
It's almost our tūranga waiwai, where you put your stake in the ground and say this is where we are.
But some say that way of life is helping push whitebait, the post larvae of 5 different species of native fish, to the brink of extinction.
Here are species that are in trouble, and there's like no limit at all to the amount that you can catch.
Forest and Birds' Kevin Haig, a West Coaster.
4 out of 5 are moving towards extinction.
He reflects on a different era.
There are accounts of so much whitebait being caught that it just had to be buried on the beach, basically.
Was that pre-refrigeration, though?
I can't tell you. I don't know.
What everyone does agree on, though, is that humans are having a huge impact on their habitat.
There are really substantial pressures on these fish from habitat loss and water quality and issues like that. Fixing those problems, okay, is a long-term, slow process. These fish are under massive pressure. Whitebaiting is one of those pressures.
Forest and Bird wants restrictions on how we catch whitebait, how much we can catch, and a complete commercial ban.
We don't want to interfere with someone's ability to go and get a feed for their family or something like that.
No one wants to see whitebait extinct, but here's the issue. Norm, Nan, Kevin, even the panel of experts who say these fish are threatened, know hardly anything about whitebait numbers.
You know, there is no record of whitebait catch in New Zealand since the 1970s on any sort of general scale.
Dr. Mike Hickford, a marine ecologist who specialises in whitebait at the University of Canterbury.
So yeah, basing an argument around the fact that the whitebait catch is declining is just basing it on a falsehood. There is no data to suggest that.
Forest and Bird are saying that whitebait are facing extinction. Do you buy that?
I buy bits of it. So the distinction that needs to be made is between whitebait and adults. And there's no doubt that the adult stage of these fish are in trouble, but it doesn't translate to the whitebait.
And that's because adult fish spawn in such huge numbers. And yes, this is an adult whitebait.
The majority of those whitebait that are coming back into the river, they're going to die anyway. They always have died, and they still will die in the future as well, no matter what we do.
Dr. Hickford says if whitebaiters weren't catching them, they'd die through natural causes, starvation, being caught by birds, or gobbled up by trout. So does whitebaiting actually affect the threatened adult population?
There's no evidence to suggest at this stage that it impacts the adults.
So while everyone agrees the adults are in trouble because of their habitat loss, that doesn't necessarily mean whitebait are in trouble.
The suggestion is that people are catching less, but we know that more people are fishing. The fishery itself has a long history of peaks and lows. So, you know, there's a good year, there's a bad year. It changes regionally.
Good data around whitebait numbers could potentially end the debate, but people have been discussing the lack of it for decades.
Whitebaiters are notorious liars. They don't like to tell you how much they caught the day before, let alone over the course of the season, because you know, if you tell them, then someone will be there fishing with you the next day.
Do you think we should come up with better data before making a big decision like this?
Absolutely not. Of all of our native fish, the only one that has legal protection is the grayling, which is already extinct.
What happens if we get this wrong, if we wipe out whitebait?
You know, I don't think we will ever wipe out whitebait.
But if you're still feeling guilty about tucking into whitebait fritters, at the other end of the country, a company in Warkworth, just north of Auckland, may have the answer. So, Paul, these are adult whitebait.
They certainly are, Matt.
Paul Decker's farming whitebait.
That water's been filtered. Would you drink that? Beautiful.
The up for anything joker has been for a decade.
A small group of us decided to start a freshwater environmental fish hatchery with the idea that people were breeding kiwis and tuataras, but no one was breeding fish. However, you have to make a living. And the idea is that to commercially produce whitebait in a sustainable fashion.
Are you making any money?
Oh, well, I wouldn't say we're making any money, Matt. That might be a stretch. But I think we have lots of tax deductions for the future.
Fair to say, it hasn't been easy.
When they're little, they climb out of the tank. And we thought we were doomed.
But Manaaki, the company Paul works for, has produced nearly 2 tonne of farm whitebait from these fish in the last 18 months.
Can you keep up with demand?
Oh, definitely not. No, no, no. The demand is hundreds and hundreds of tonne.
Paul says it's just money that's holding them back.
It's not an industry that you can backyard farm in the carport.
And while whitebaiters are limited to a season, Manaaki is close to delivering sustainably farmed fresh product all year round.
Is this the answer to what some are calling a whitebait crisis?
Oh, very much so. Farming the species is the end of the problem.
The reproduction process carefully managed. And you might want to look away. Here they're stripping eggs from the females. Milt from the males.
The big question is, Paul, does farm whitebait taste any good?
Listen, Matt, I might be biased, might not. It tastes better than wild. We come in the morning and we don't feed them breakfast and then we kill them. And so they've got a clean gut. It's called purging. So ours aren't full of shit.
Nice hot plate, good bit of oil. Fair number of whitebait.
This chef,
well, you've got to be generous,
has served up about 15,000 poo-free fritters.
That is delicious. Good stuff.
I don't know that I can taste a difference between this and the wild stuff.
Which all bodes well for the future.
Commercial farming in New Zealand is now a commercial reality.
Back on the Cascade River, Nan's also optimistic.
In time to come, we'll be thinking, what were we worrying about? For heaven's sake, we're digging it back into the garden again.
Ugh, imagine digging it into the garden. Well, the Department of Conservation, which manages the fishery, is investigating the options for improving whitebait sustainability. They'll give their recommendations to the minister by the end of the year.